Hi, so thank you for inviting me. And, you know, when I heard that Guido got the Nobel Prize, I was like, yeah, yeah, no pressure. I'll do such a good keynote, there will be no comparison. So hi, I'm Sara Magliacane. I'm from the University of Amsterdam and MIT, the MIT IBM Watson AI Lab. And today I wanted to talk to you about causality-inspired machine learning, as we call it. And in general, this is about the ideas that we can use from causality so that we can improve machine learning, in particular its robustness and its safety. And I think I'm preaching to the choir, so we all agree causality is super important, it's ubiquitous. There are many questions that do require causal knowledge. But maybe a slightly less represented view is that causality also allows us to reason systematically about distribution shifts. And so this is something that, for example, Carlos was mentioning about, and also Oke did mention about a bit when he was talking about the model drift. And so obviously I'm not the only one thinking this, so there are several papers and this is just a collage of the ones that, you know, I found and I have read, and there are many, many more, and many more are coming. So it's a very hot area. And so, you know, this started, at least as far as I know, this started at least in ICML 2012. And so it's been like the connections between causality and improving robustness of machine learning have been kind of well known for a while. And just maybe to drive home the point, this is not a purely academic interest. So a lot of the papers that I actually put here, you know, not by chance, are also from companies. So they're from Google, from IBM, from Microsoft, from Amazon, and from Facebook. And so this is also like, how to improve robustness is also clearly interesting for tech. So first, maybe I'll give you like a very short example, since it's just after, you know, dinner or breakfast, depending where you are, or lunch, I guess. So I'll give you a first example of why it's important that machine learning algorithms are robust distribution shift. So maybe you already know this story. This is a story about a horse called Clever Hans. So in the beginning of the century in Germany, there was this horse. And the idea was that the owner would ask the horse a mathematical question, like, what is 1 + 2? And the horse would tap his hoof for 3 times. And then the question was, everybody was thinking maybe it's a scam. So there was a, you know, a proper investigation by researchers, and you can read about it online. But one of the findings was that essentially the horse was able to get some clues from the person asking the questions. So if the person was asking the questions and they asked, what is, you know, 5 - 2? And the horse would tap once, it would tap twice, it would tap 3 times, and the person, you know, was flustered, then the horse would stop. And so, you know, then, you know, the horse would have learned the correct answer, but not for the correct reason. And so this is the Clever Hans effect, when, you know, you have maybe an algorithm that is able to learn the correct answer, but it doesn't mean that it's actually learning anything, it's just kind of able to essentially game the system of applying heuristics. Or in other, you know, in other places it's being said like it's right for the wrong reasons. And so maybe to give you an example, in computer vision, there is this kind of slightly older data set from 2016, which was, you know, the first time I heard about this Clever Hans effect. And it's a data set on visual question answering. And so you have these images, and then maybe you have some questions. So the question is, what color is the jacket in the picture? So there's a jacket here. And there is the colors are red and blue, yellow, black, orange, and it's red and blue, if you can see with the image. So this is the task, visual question answering. And so in this older data set, you know, pre-2016, the authors here managed to find that a lot of the baselines were actually doing like a decent job, let's say here. But if they train just an MLP, which just used the answer, so you throw away the image, you throw away the, you know, the question, you just use the answer, and you essentially just train an MLP on the answer, you would get similar results to the state of the art. And so the idea was that the data set, for example, was quite biased, so most of the images, you know, were taken by day. And so if you have a question which you had, what time of the day is it, you know, it's the, was the picture taken, daytime was a good answer. Or in general, if you had colors, it was a lot of grass, a lot of, you know, trees, so green was a good answer. So essentially, this is what the visual question answering systems were often learning, these kind of simple heuristics. And so the way that this was solved in visual question answering was they introduced new data sets, which were trying to diagnose and be very careful about data set bias. And so in another, so this is not just, you know, for computer vision and visual question answering, in another domain, for example, in NLP, there is this task called natural language inference. And the idea is that you have, you know, a sentence, a premise, for example, the doctor was visited by the judge. And then you have a hypothesis. And the hypothesis is the judge visited the doctor. And so these sentences are equivalent. So you would say, in this case, there is an entailment from the premise to the hypothesis. And so if you do train BERT, and you train it on the standard data set, MNLI, that people use for natural language inference, you would get very good results. But then the authors of this paper, so this is from ACL 2019, so much more recent, they found out that there are few heuristics that you can think about. For example, you could just, you know, learn the overlap of the words. So the doctor appears in both sentences, visited to, judged to. So essentially, a heuristic, which just means, you know, if two sentences have the same words or a high overlap, then they are entailed, works pretty well because most of the sentences which have a high overlap, they're actually entailed. And so what they did is they created like tricky sentences like this one here. So in this sense, it's a bit tricky even for humans. It's like the doctor was visited by the judge and the doctor visited the judge. So essentially they are like, the first one is the passive voice and the second is the active voice. So they're not entailed. And so what they did is they did a new data set that they called TAMS, as you can imagine. And so in this data set, they had half of the, you know, simple sentences, and then they added half of the sentences, which were these tricky versions. And so what happened is that on the simple sentences, obviously the machine learning algorithms were actually picking up on several different types of heuristics, but on the tricky ones, the results were actually quite bad. And so the idea is that this kind of leads us to think that BERT and the other methods, which are state of the art in NLP, were actually just picking up on this kind of simple overlap heuristic or some other simple overlap heuristics. And so the idea that, you know, that the authors propose to solve it is to do that augmentation. So you do know which are these heuristics, so you can train the model to, you know, fit these heuristics and essentially to be able to deal with these kind of tricky sentences. But the question is, what happens if you don't know which are the heuristics that the model is using? And so going back to causality, the idea is that I really like to think that causality is a way to do it, to do this kind of reasoning systematically. And so especially, and this is maybe my biases are showing, so especially through causal graphs, right? And so I was actually looking at all of these papers. And again, you can imagine I chose them because they are, you know, close to the papers I like. So they do tend to have all different, slightly different graphs, but all kind of graphs nevertheless. And my hope is that at the end of this talk, you could be able to at least understand how people did create these graphs and how they're using them. And so, and especially, and this is, I think, very interesting, because I think, I mean, like Carlos already talked about transportability and, you know, generalization, etc. I think that one interesting thing is even when you don't know the graph, you don't have the selection diagram, you don't know, you know some things, but maybe you don't know everything. Even if the graph is unknown, you can sometimes use, you can sometimes reason about distribution shift through causal reasoning. And even more, even if you have essentially missing data, and this is the paper we did in 2018, even if you do have missing data, so even you cannot reconstruct the equivalence class of the graphs, so the Markov equivalence class, you cannot reconstruct it because some data are missing, so some conditional inferences, you cannot do them, you can still do something about it. So this is what I hope in the end of the talk you will be convinced about. So I start with an example, and this is a bit back to the basics, because after I've seen the talks, especially the one from Carlos, I think you guys are much more advanced than I thought. So let's go back to the basics. So this is, you know, an example of a structural causal model. And let's say I chose an example in which I have a log, and I have logged how much food, how much calories I eat every day, how much exercise I eat every day, my basal metabolic rate, and I love my weight loss because I'm trying to see, you know, I want to lose weight, so I want to see how I'm losing weight. And so there is this rule of thumb that you may have heard that is essentially if you have, you know, a deficit of calories and you divide it by 7,700, which is supposedly not an arbitrary number, then you can show that you will lose 1 kilo, more or less, or 1 kilo of fat. So that's why there is a tilde there, like more or less. And so we can write that formula there. So this formula here, we can write it and we can just call weight loss WL. And so WL is a function of food calories, FC, exercise calories, EC, and the BMR, so the basal metabolic rate, which is the calories you spend just being alive. And so the idea is, okay, it's, you know, as I said, it's more or less. So maybe we can also add some probabilities. And so here I'm trying to explain to you, you know, why structural causal models are so nice, because you can add these kind of exogenous variables, for example, you done. And essentially this will allow you to model some noise, which is in this formula, or some kind of personal factors, or any kind of, you know, probabilistic version essentially of this rule of thumb. And so I'm drawing this U of W as, you know, an observed variable, which is like a bit shaded, like lightly shaded, and with this dotted kind of thing around it. And so we can write a structural causal model, and I think you guys are beyond that, but just, you know, to give you the whole run. So we can write it like this, and we can also have these exogenous variables for, you know, the food calories, the exercise calories, and BMR. Because maybe, you know, there is a certain distribution. I don't always eat 1,200 calories every day. So there's a certain distribution. So I can model the distribution with this unobserved exogenous variable UFC. Or also for exercise, you know, things are quite stochastic. So I can model stochasticity through this UEC. And also the BMR is based on your weight. So it should slowly decrease. So even this kind of distribution is modeled here. And so the idea is, I usually have these kind of latent variables, but just for simplicity, I will not draw it. And that's, you know, convention. We generally don't draw it. Okay, yes. Okay, it's appearing. And then I can also add another variable, for example, my motivation to actually pursue weight loss. And so M is a function of my weight loss. Let's say that, you know, when I'm losing weight, I get more motivated. So there is a function, let's say FM, which is a function just of weight loss. And so essentially in the graph that we are drawing, on the left-hand side, we have the variables, and on the right-hand side, we have the parents of the variables. And we connect the parents with an edge. So this is the general idea. And we can also model soft interventions. So I start with the more general version, so soft interventions. And soft interventions, for example, a soft intervention on N is just the idea that I will change the equation of M with another equation. So just use another function. Maybe because, you know, I was, you know, reading about it, and I know that, you know, I used to be more concerned about my weight loss and my, you know, motivation to lose weight. They were more connected, more correlated, but now I read more about it, and therefore the correlation is slightly less. And so I can change my function here. So this is a soft intervention, for example. Another intervention is a perfect intervention. And in this case, I'm intervening on M, and it means I will kind of just cut the edges incoming from weight loss to M, because now suddenly I decide, for example, that, you know, like my motivation is regardless my weight loss. And so this would be a perfect intervention when a variable becomes independent of its parent. So I'm cutting the incoming edges. So after now, it was, you know, super standard, but now I wanted to really like drive a bit home the point. And this is a bit similar to selection diagrams, but not completely. And we can discuss that maybe in the questions if you want. So I want to be able to represent with a single causal diagram three different distributions, because maybe I have, you know, three different data sets. For example, I want to, you know, be able to represent with, you know, the observational case in which I have, you know, F of M. So the motivation is F of M of WL. Maybe I want to have another soft intervention case in which M is F of MK, when, you know, you have learned more about weight loss and therefore the function has changed. Or maybe M is also F star of M, in which suddenly M is not related, is not connected anymore, is not caused anymore by weight loss. And so I can just represent this with a single graph, very simply by adding this E variable, E because, you know, people call it environment or domain or regimes. And this is an idea that shows up over and over again in several works. And so the idea is that if I have this E can act as a switch. So when E is zero, I will use one function. When E is one, I'll use another. When E is two, I'll use another one. And so I'll just have G, which is the function that, you know, motivation is based on G, will also have E as a parameter. And so in this graph, I can represent several distributions, observational, soft interventions, and let's say interventions. And in general, I can also represent, let's say, different distributions from conceptually different observational distributions. For example, I have my log but maybe, you know, I have a friend and he has also lock, my, you know, my green friend. And then I have a purple friend and my purple friend also has another lock. And we all have slightly, you know, different habits in, you know, how we eat and how we exercise and the BMR. And our relationship between, you know, the weight loss and our motivation is different. And so what will happen, I will just add the environment variable, and this will be causing all of the things that are different across us. And I can represent all of our data in a single graph and with a single structural causal model. And so the idea is, so this, as I said, this is not, you know, my idea, this kind of shows up repeatedly. People rediscover it, people reuse it. And it's in a lot of the papers also I have shown before. Some of the things we actually did provide that is slightly different. And, you know, the reason, one of the reasons is also because we wanted to learn essentially these selection diagrams or things that look a bit like selection diagrams from data, is we proposed this joint causal inference. And in this case, we wanted also to disentangle the changes in each data set. So instead of having one environmental variable, we added several context variables, we call them. And the idea is that if we have, you know, these three people, we can just, you know, add three kind of context variables here. So we add three columns, and, you know, these columns, so the first column is only one, let's say, for my data points, and it's zero for all the other people. And the second column, so the second context variable is zero for my data points, and is only one for, you know, my green friend. And the third context variable is only one for my purple friend. And so these are like, you know, data sets, three data sets that we can put together in a single table. You know, in Excel, you can do it, so why not? So essentially, we can do this, and the idea is we can do this very simple thing, and then we can consider, so we can have some extra assumptions, and that's why the paper is actually quite long and surprisingly complicated. But we can show essentially that it's kosher to put everything together, and then we can treat this as if it was observational data, and then we can learn a structure on this. And so this is the work we have done in this joint causal inference paper. And so, okay, and so, you know, before I had like three context variables, but for simplicity, we can also remove one because, you know, then we can encode people like my, you know, my purple friend is 0, 0, my green friend is 0, 1, and I'm 1, 0. And so these are perfectly enough to encode the differences between us. And so the idea is that if I have this, you know, this table in which I put all of the samples together, then I can essentially represent the same data with a graph. And the graph will have this E here, this is from before, that encodes all the changes. But because now I have the different C1 and C2, I can split the E in two parts. So for example, maybe my friend, my purple friend here, actually has very similar habits to me. So actually, the only difference is that he is much more optimistic. So I will just have an edge from C1 that represents actually me to motivation. And C2 instead, let's say my green friend is much more similar to me, but on the other hand, he may have like different habits. And so I can essentially disentangle the different contributions in the different data sets. And so now we have a graph, it's a standard graph, we can use this separation, we can use the calculus. And so that was the idea, to essentially go back to a very simple structure that we can also learn from data. And so now, okay, so now we have a way to encode, you know, different data sets in a single graph. Fantastic. But, you know, why should we care? So first, I wanted to maybe give you like an idea of the different tasks that you can use in transfer learning, in which causality could be useful. So the first one is, let's say, multi-source domain adaptation, like the supervised version. So let's assume now I have, for my friends, I have all of the data, and so they are source domains. And for me, instead, I'm trying to predict my weight loss, but I don't have some of the data, so some of the data are missing here. So my data is the target domain. And it's supervised because I do have some values, but not all of them. And so now the question is essentially, how can I estimate something that predicts the weight loss from the other features? And so maybe to make it a bit more formal, let's assume I call just all of the features X1, X2, and X3, and X4. So these are like my features, as in, you know, in classification. And Y is my label. And so now my task is to essentially learn a model that is able to predict why well from the source domains in a way that it would also transfer well to the target domain, and I can also use some of this data. So this is supervised multi-source domain adaptation. A more complicated case is unsupervised multi-source domain adaptation. So in this case, I actually don't have any data for me. So there are no labels in the target. The target is completely unlabeled. And so in this case, I want to exploit the source data to learn my estimator of why. But I also want to exploit essentially some of the data I have. So I have some data on the covariates or features or how you want to call them in the target domain. So I can maybe use them to compare with the other covariates to see what has shifted and what hasn't shifted. And so this is essentially one of the ideas that I will talk about more in detail later. So this is one of the settings, a supervised multi-source domain adaptation. And the final setting, and I think this is, you know, important to have them distinguished because people tend to confuse them, is domain generalization. So in this case, we want to be able to generalize under any intervention. So we essentially, we do have the source domains as before, but we don't really have a target domain. There is no data. Nothing is here. And so the question is, how can I find like a predictor F hat such that it will generalize regardless what happens in the target domain? And as you can imagine, this is generally quite difficult, but let's assume one can see this as an intervention on all other variables except the label Y. And then in some cases, you can use the causal parents to generalize. And I'll show an example when this fails a bit later, but it's generally related to the presence of latent confounders. So now I'll give a very quick, very quick example of unsupervised domain adaptation, which is will be most of my focus. And for now, I'll have a lot of simplifying assumptions. So one is there is only one source and one target domain. So C is either zero or one. Simple. We assume we know the graph, and it's this very, very simple graph. And so now the question is, what features can we use? Shall we use X1 to predict Y? Shall we use X2 to predict Y? So we use X1 and X2 to predict Y. Which one shall we use? And so I will actually relax these assumptions later. So we'll not have the graph, we'll have more than one source and possibly also more than one domain. But for now, let's start with this one. So I think this is actually very similar to the criterion that is in the selection diagrams, the transportability criterion. I think people have been reinventing also this criterion a few times. I think they are called as stable features, invariant features, et cetera. So unfortunately, we didn't know that. So we called them separating features in 2018. And the idea is we just want features that de-separate Y, which is the label we're trying to predict, from C, which is the context variable. Or in other cases, let's say the context variable that represents the target domain. So we have multiple context variables. And so the idea is we want to use essentially this separation. And you know, for the people who don't know, this separation is a criterion that allows us, given a graph and under some assumptions, to read conditional independences from the graphical structure. And so I will just give you, I don't have the time to actually define this separation, although I would really like to, but I hope if you're interested, you look it up. But I will just give you a very quick intuition of how it works. So let's assume I choose X1 as a predictor of Y. So I want to know if X1 is a separating feature, and this is, you know, the de-separation statement I'm looking for. So I just want to know if Y is de-separated from C given X1. And essentially, de-separation means that X1 has to block all of the paths. So just, you know, to give you a very simple example, there is a path from C through X1 to Y. And when I condition an X1 like this, I can show that, you know, this path is blocked. And so you have to believe me, but just to give me, you know, just to give you an intuition, if you do have the BMR and you know the weight loss, you don't. My motivation doesn't care about the BMR. My motivation is fine with the weight loss. So knowing the weight loss will kind of block the influence of the BMR to the motivation. And so this is a similar type of path than the one that you have here. And so there is another path in this graph. There are only two. So this path is from C through X2 to Y. And so in this case, the question is, does X1 de-separate also this path? And the answer is yes, it does. And you can think of it conceptually as, you know, the calories I eat are independent from the calories that, you know, I spend exercising, regardless of the fact that they both cause the weight loss. And so this is, let's say, a simple example. And so we can show that X1 is, you know, a set of features that, you know, is a separating set. And this means, and, you know, very simply, if you have this separation, you can show that, you know, or actually, essentially by assumption, you assume that this condition dependence holds. And this condition dependence, you can just write it down as the fact that the condition distribution of Y given X1 in the source and in the target are the same. So this is like just by how you rewrite condition dependencies. And maybe this doesn't mean much to you, but maybe we can just look at the data. So you have Y here and X1 here. And so if we look only at the data from the source domain, so these green ones here, and we fit a line, and so this line is essentially the, it's kind of doing the conditional distribution of Y given X1. So this line would still work even for the target data. So the target data are these blue circles here. So a line from, you know, that is only learned using, you know, the green data will also work on the blue data. So this means essentially that, you know, this is a good predictor, even for the linear case. And now we can check X2. And, you know, is X2 a good predictor? And so the question, the answer is no. So if we look at this path that we had before, now we're not conditioning anymore on X1, and therefore this path is open, and therefore we know they're not de-separated, they're deconnected. And so this is similar to the case in which the BMR actually may influence my motivation if I don't know what is my weight loss. So this is the DM. And on the other hand, this is a bit a more complicated case, even the other path. So we didn't even need to check this path because the other path was already open, so it's already a problem, but just to check also this other path, even in this other path creates a problem because when I condition X2, X2 is a collider, which is a structure in which two edges are coming in. And when I condition it, I open this path through from C through X2 to Y. And so this is the idea that, you know, if I know I have lost weight and I know I haven't had any deficit, then definitely I must have done a lot of exercise. And so essentially the calories that I eat and the calories that, you know, I spend in exercise are not independent anymore if I know my weight loss, essentially. And just to give you an intuition. And so X2 is a horrible predictor, really bad. And so I can show you even in the plots, it's even more clear that it's really bad. So here we still have Y on this axis and X2 on this axis. And again, we will try to fit with the source domain, just, you know, linear regression line, it will be horrible for the target domain, it's completely wrong. And even worse, in our unsupervised domain adaptation case, we actually never see Y, so we don't know what's happening. We just could have essentially potentially arbitrary large error. So X2 is very biased and we shouldn't use it. And so X1 is a separating feature, X2 is a bad feature, is not a separating feature, and X1 to, and X2 together are also not good because X2 essentially rebiases things. And I think essentially this is not something new, it's more like a summary of things we have apparently rediscovered. But one of the things that people don't realize, I mean, people who know realize, but the people who don't know so much maybe don't realize, is that you know, these separating features are not necessarily causal. So I can completely have this X3 and, you know, I can show and, you know, trust me on this, unless you want to learn this separation immediately, that X1 and X3 are both separating sets. So both of them are good predictors and maybe X3 actually help us in predicting Y. It's even better than just having X1. And so separating features are, they need not to be causal. So they don't need to be parents of Y. And so this is the difference a bit with domain generalization. In domain generalization, you generally would prefer to have the causal parents because you would think that everything can be intervened and therefore most of things would have either this situation or they would be kind of not important. So you can always take the parents. And this is just maybe to drive another point home. If you do have latent variables, latent confounders, for example, this one H, sometimes even the causal parents cannot really help you. And so sometimes there are other features that you should be using. And so in this case, X2 is a parent of Y, but we can see from the deseparations and deconnections that X2 is not a good feature using our definition. And even adding X1 and X2 together actually creates more problems. And that's because essentially X2 opens this path here. But in any case, if you do know this separation and you know the graph, you can figure out which is a good set, essentially, that has like bounded generalization shift, and it's not necessarily dependent. So now I will talk a bit about an example. So I wanted to talk about this, actually this data set that we use in this causal domain adaptation paper. So we focused on unsupervised multi-source adaptation, and multi-source, just, I forgot to mention it before, but it just means that there are multiple source domains. And so in this paper, we focus on this data set because we were actually competing in a causality competition. And so we had some mice, and for each mouse, we had some phenotypes, for example, I don't know, height and weight. And then maybe we wanted to predict something else, for example, a color, another phenotype. And we had a few samples from normal mice, but we also had a few samples from mice which were genetically modified. And we didn't know what the gene was actually doing because we only had phenotypes. So the distribution was different, but we didn't know exactly how. And then finally, we had our target set, and there were mice which in which the another gene was modified. And so in this case, we wanted to predict, let's say, or label wife. And so in this case, we needed some assumptions. So some of them are quite technical, but we can also discuss them a bit later if you're interested, or you can check in the paper. But one of the assumptions that we had, and as far as I know, almost everybody has, is that the label Y cannot be intervened upon directly. And when I say intervene upon, I mean that, let's say, there is no edge from the context variable to the label Y in the target domain, because otherwise we're not able to transfer anything to this domain. If in this domain things change, and it doesn't change in a way mediated through the other variables. But this doesn't mean that the distribution of Y cannot change. It can still change through the other variables. And so in this case, the problem was that the graph was unknown. And even worse, I mean, you know, if the graph is unknown, you're like, okay, I can do conditional dependencies. In the end, I want conditional dependencies, right? No, because in our case, we have, you know, the unsupervised domain adaptation case, we didn't have any data in the target domain. And so we couldn't test these conditional dependencies. And we needed to be very, very careful about which conditional dependencies we could do, because anything that used Y had to be conditioned on the fact that it was in the source domains. And so the idea was, actually, we can just do a lot of other conditional dependencies, and then maybe we can use, so we had a theorem prover, maybe we can try to prove somehow, and I will show you how, or like, you know, high level, how we can essentially prove these conditional dependencies that we cannot test from the other conditional dependencies that we can test. And so we needed some assumptions, for example, the fact that Y was not intervened directly, and some other technical assumptions, and we needed this joint causal inference work that we had. And so now to go back to the joint causal inference that I discussed before in this context, which we also have missing data. What we did is we did a lot of conditional dependence tests, but we had to be careful if Y was in the conditional dependence test, we needed to condition on the fact that it was in the source domains. Then we could find several graphs that fit these conditional dependencies. And then we can, let's say, we can represent them with a single graph in which these dotted lines are edges that can or cannot be there. But then the idea that in all of these graphs, actually, we could prove that Y was separated from C1 conditioning X1, if there is this edge or not. This would always be blocking it. So this is like a minimal example that we can, you know, we prove by hand. And so, and it doesn't matter if there is this edge or not here, X1 is could be bad, could be not bad, we're not sure, but just in case, we're not going to use it. And so this was done by hand, you know, by proving theorems by hand. So we thought maybe we should just use a theorem prover. And so in this theorem prover, we started with a query. We wanted to check, for example, if X1 was a separating set. We have some assumptions. We throw all the testable conditional independencies that we had, you know, carefully, so that when Y was there, we'd only use source data. We use the logic encoding of this separation, and then we throw everything in a theorem prover. And the theorem prover would spit out essentially three options. And one was provably separating, which means in all of the graphs that fit essentially these conditional dependencies and these assumptions, in all of them, this X1 would separate Y from C1. Another option is probably not separating, which means in all of the graphs that fit the data, it doesn't happen, or simply it's not identifiable. So in some it does, in some it doesn't, I'm not sure which is the correct graph. And so we use this method in a very simple causal feature selection algorithm. And the idea was first step, we use the source domains data, and then we did standard feature selection. And just with the source domains, we would list, you know, which features, and by features, I mean both, you know, the features X1 and X2, et cetera, but also these context variables we use as features. So we have like sets of features that are most predictive in the source domain. Then, for example, we select a new set. Let's start with, you know, the top set, the set which has, you know, the smallest loss in the source domain for predicting Y. And then we would just kind of use our theorem prover to check if this set would actually work. And maybe, for example, let's assume in this case, this set doesn't work, so we cannot prove it separating. So then we would just, you know, iterate and take a new set. And so the idea would again do it until we could find the set that was probably separating. So we just try everything. So that's why it's very simple. It's kind of brute force. And just follow down and find the set that was probably separating. And probably separating just means it can guarantee us that regardless of what the intervention is in the target domain, because we cannot see what Y is doing, under some assumptions, obviously, but regardless of the intervention, we can still bound the generalization error. And so now we have this set S that we can prove is probably separating, and then we can learn this function F hat of S just using the source domain data. And if this doesn't happen, we just iterate, we continue iterating until we find one. But let's assume we find it. And then we can just, once we have learned F hat, we can just use it on the, you know, on the target domain to estimate Y. And we can prove, and we have some proofs in the paper, that the generalization error is bounded. And so this was like our older work. Now I'm going to talk about an application of this work. So we have a new MIT EVM project in which we're trying to apply this work to cross-species translation. And so this is with Daniel Zhu and Douglas Laufenberger and some other folks from IBM. And the idea is that, I'm not sure whether you guys know it, but a lot of drugs which are tested in mice, so in the preclinical studies, up to 10% of the drugs which pass the preclinical studies actually do not, only 10% pass, sorry, only 10% of drugs which do pass the preclinical study do also pass the clinical trials, which means they're effective for humans. Only 10% of the things that are affecting on mice are affecting on humans. And we're not sure exactly how the physiology translates. And so this is cross-species translation. We want to know how the physiology translates. And so there is some work actually from the PI from MIT who's working with us on how to do computational modeling for this cross-species translation. And most of the approaches try to find things that mice and humans have in common. And instead, our hope is essentially by using the state-of-the-art domain adaptation approaches, for example, the one I showed before, that we should be able to do better. And so, for example, this is just an example of what we would like to have. And the example is we have some control mice, maybe we have some treated mice, maybe we also have some other species. So at the moment, actually, this is not happening, but you know, this is the hope. And then we have some humans, and the humans have some, for example, gene expressions. And we want to classify the humans. For example, now we're looking into tuberculosis. We want to classify the humans, like who of the humans have tuberculosis. And we want to learn it through mice and essentially the distribution of the gene expressions in the humans. So this is one of the use cases that we're looking into. And now for something in a sense completely different, I'm going to talk about another method. So not the method I mentioned, but it's still a method that uses ideas from causality for domain adaptation. And so this is a method here. It's a YouTube video from Kun Zhang talking about it on the online causal inference seminar. This is a method on data-driven domain adaptation. And the idea is that you do have this graph and you have these theta parameters that can encode the changes. So instead of the context variables that we had, in their cases, their parameters are thetas because They want them to be not just zero and one, they want them to actually be numbers so that they can estimate them more efficiently. And the idea is if you do estimate these on a set of source domains, when you're in a new target domain, you can just estimate a subset of the thetas and the rest is the same. And so we actually have used this method, we have collaborated and we have used this method in something that is a bit of a work in progress. So I wanted maybe to tease you a bit with this. So it's an application to fast policy adaptation, so to reinforcement learning. So the idea is, for example, we have Pong, and here we're playing Pong normally in this direction. Maybe we have another source domain, we're playing Pong, but we have rotated Pong, so we're playing in this other direction. Here we have added noise to Pong, so we have a set of different source domains. And we want to essentially be able to learn a model such that we're able to learn from the images a representation that is shared and kind of semantically sensible and disentangled here. And then we want to learn domain-specific parameters. For example, we want to learn something about the noise value. And there are some assumptions with respect to the previous work. For example, one of the assumptions, there are no new edges in the target, which is something we didn't consider in the method before. So we don't have this simplifying assumption. And so using this model estimation that we estimate on the source domains, we're able to then identify, we can prune it a bit to just use a subset of the states, and then we can do policy learning on the source domain. So we can learn pi star, and the pi star is parametrizing these domain specific parameters. When we're in a target domain, we already have the policy, we can just learn the values of these thetas, and then we can apply the policy. And it seems to work quite decently. So, maybe next time we talk, I hope we'll have a better results. So maybe just to come to the conclusions, I think maybe in a kind of a roundabout way, I hope I did convince you that causal graphs and this operation are a principal way to reason about invariances in distribution shifts. And especially I wanted to also convince you that this can also happen, and this is completely not obvious, if the graph is unknown and even when there is missing data or conditional dependencies. And especially with the missing data and conditional dependencies, logic-based methods like Hittin and et al. From 2014 seem to actually help us deal with the fact that some of the conditional dependencies are missing. And so, as I said, there is a lot of work that I hope you'll see. And so that's it. Thank you.